Panther Pride 82. Brought to you by Daily Juice Product. To remind you, there's a Daily's treat for everyone. And by Westinghouse and the 140,000 Westinghouse employees worldwide.
Illinois 26-6. People did not know at that point how good Illinois really was. Well, the Illini went on to register a fine campaign of 7-4, and this year they're expected to perhaps challenge for the top honors in the Big Ten. For Pitt, things don't get any easier. A standing room only crowd of more than 71,000 turns up at Memorial Stadium for what some folks in Illinois calling the biggest football game to be played in that state in 18 years. The 18th ranked Illini fired up for a try at knocking the Panthers off the top of the heap. Illinois has the weapons. The rifle arm of senior quarterback Tony Eason propels the Illini to a 3-0 start in 82. Illinois averaging more than 400 yards per game offensively thanks to Eason's talents and the coaching of Mike White, who learned the passing game from the coach of the Super Bowl champion 49ers, Bill Walsh. Illinois is pushing Eason as a Heisman Trophy candidate. Mention Heisman Trophy, you've got to mention the name of Dan Marino, Pitt's quarterback extraordinaire. He's led the Panthers to 2 wins in 2 games, but Marino has suffered 5 interceptions, and fans are having doubts that Pitt's offense will ever get itself untracked. Maybe today is the day. And then again, maybe it's not.
Backer to the wide side. The right is Dwight Collins. Pitt with a 3rd-and-9 at its own 23. Marino back to pass. Over the middle of the pass. Intercepted at the 30-yard line. Breaks the tackle. That's Mike Heaven. And Mike Heaven is tackled at the Pitt 28. And the Illini come up with a big break right off the bat.
Martin flanked to one side. Williams is the flanker to the left. Martin split right. Eason on 3rd-and-9 is back to pass.
Out of the pocket he comes. Forward to the 30. Being chased at the 25. And he gets down to the 22-yard line. He'll be short of first down yardage.
This will be a 39-yard field goal attempt for kicker Mike Bass, who's perfect on the season so far. Angle to the left. Ball is on the tee. The kick is up, and the kick is good. Illinois takes a 3-0 lead.
For the third week in a row, the Panthers have allowed the opposition the luxury of the game's first score. And for the third week in succession, it appears that the Panthers are about to compound the felony. Chris Sigourney's second quarter punt is fumbled by Tom Flynn at the 16-yard line.
Back split wide behind Champagne Tony. He shifts him a little more to the right side. He rolls to the right. Tony firing for the sideline. The pass is pulled in at the 5-yard line and knocked out of bounds at the 1 is Oliver Williams with a great catch on the far sideline.
Tony Eason steps under center. The give off the right side to Mitchell Brookins. He's hit and knocked down at the line of scrimmage. No gain. Right side of the field to the left. Short pocket floater pass for the corner of the end zone. It is incomplete.
Not only does the Panthers' physical defense keep Illinois out of the end zone, that D goes on the O. Pressure from the Pitt goal line defenders, freshman Bob Shilkin and sophomore Chris Dolman cause Eason to throw a pass to a highly unlikely receiver. Defensive tackles don't often get chances to show their blinding speed. Look out, here comes a runaway freight train, the Pozzoli Express, and it's on time.
I was a little tired, you know, I've been nursing a slight strained ligament in my knee, but I got no excuses. I'm just lucky I had a wind at my back, I think, you know. I owe it all to my defensive teammates, because Jay threw a big block, and them guys just about carried me in. I owe it all to them.
Well, I want to tell you something about that play. When Pozzoli first caught the ball, I looked up the scoreboard. There was 12 minutes to go in the quarter. Then when he crossed the end zone, there was 8 minutes to go. I'm not saying he's slow, but he could have picked up his pace a little bit.
Coach Fazio whispered to me as I run by. He says, kill some of the clock. And that's what I done. Yeah. I was tempted to get some oxygen. I was right there. Nah, I was just lucky I had a window like that.
Show their support at Pitt Stadium. Panther fans like to take that blue and gold support on the road. And so it was Saturday in Champaign that a couple of area Golden Panther chapters made the long hike out that way to show their support. And we're talking about a busload of fans from the Laurel Golden Panther chapter and also a busload from the Beaver Valley. The Pitt Pep Band was there to lead the cheers late third quarter as Dan Marino directed the Panthers to a touchdown drive, 49 yards in 5 plays.
First and 10, Pitt at the Illinois 49. I formation. Now they shift out of it on the audible by Marino. Flanker right is Collins. Short pocket pass to the outside, complete to Julius Dawkins. His first reception of the game. It comes forward to the 44-yard line of the Illini for a 5-yard gain. Mike Heaven, the cornerback, made the tackle on the play. Marino, short pocket pass over the middle, wide open. Dwight Collins, first down at the 30, shakes one tackler, shakes a second, but can't get it going, and down he goes at the 30-yard line in Illinois territory, a 13-yard gain. Cornerback Charles Armstead finally made the tackle with help from Craig Swoop, the free safety. First and 10, Pitt at the 30 of the Illini. Another audible from Marino. Flanker right is Clark. Split end left is Dawkins. He wants Dawkins. Dawkins pulls it in at the 24-yard line and is knocked out of bounds on the far side of the field by Mike Heaven. So that gain comes about 6 yards forward into the 24-yard line. Again, Marino to the audible. Sets him up in the I formation. And he gives it to the tailback. Brian Thomas breaks a hole left side. He gets across the 20 to the 16-yard line. Brian Thomas picked up 8 yards and another Panther first down. A split set in the backfield, first and 10 at the 16. Marino back to pass. Looks for the 5-yard line. John Brown, he's into the end zone for a Panther touchdown. 16-yard scoring strike, and the Panthers break out of the slump. It's Marino to Brown. Brown got by Edwards, a strong safety. Pulled it in at the 5-yard line and puts the Panther offense on the board. Pitt leads at 16-3, and Shoobie-Doo's on for the extra point try.
On that play, Danny audibles to a place called 69Y, and that's calling me to do about a 12 to 14 yard square out, and I put a move on the free safety who was covering me, and I broke it out, and apparently he wasn't close enough to keep me out of the end zone. I caught it on about the 5 and sort of walked in.
It was billed as a battle of the Heisman hopefuls, and there you see the stats individually for both Dan Marino of the Panthers and Tony Eason of the Illini. Eason managed to complete 30 passes against that Panther defense for some 270 yards, but you see that the Panthers were very effective in keeping Eason out of the end zone. Marino, meanwhile, 18 for 35, but look at those interceptions. Both defenses had a lot to say with the fact that there were 9 interceptions in the football game. Taking a look at total stats, Pitt with 136 yards rushing, 215 passing, ran 67 plays. Illinois ran it 82 snaps for 275 yards passing, but look at the rushing figure for Illinois, minus 27. I think 9 sacks of Tony Eason by the Pitt defense had a lot to do with that rushing figure. Dwight Collins, a big afternoon for the Panthers on 6 grabs, 117 yards. His long gain of 37 yards, not a bad average, 19.5 per reception. We take a look in the second quarter, the second play. Marino to Dwight Collins over the middle. Dwight with that blinding speed, 4-3 in the 40. Cutting it to the sideline. Picks up 34 yards, and on this play, Dwight Collins sets another Panther milestone. He moves into third place on the all-time Pitt yardage receiving list with 1,309, and before he's finished, the junior from Beaver Falls has a chance at Gordon Jones' all-time Pitt receiving mark of 2,230 yards. You know, a football team practices and then it plays on Saturday. Many times, how it practices will dictate how it plays. Many a game is won and lost on the practice field.
Normally in a practice session, what we try to do is break it down into a number of different areas. One, we have a specialty area, which mostly is during our kicking period in the beginning. Then we have a technique period where they just go through individual techniques. Then we get into our group periods where we have, say for instance, the running backs and the quarterbacks work together on plays. Then we get into what we call a combination period. And this is when the offense goes against the defense in different combinations. For instance, the offensive backs and receivers will go against the defensive backs and linebackers. Then we get into team time where the teams will polish up, run their plays and review. And then at the end, if we have any kind of scrimmage, like a goal line scrimmage or a regular pass type scrimmage. My function is more or less to go around and make sure that the practice schedule is being carried out to what we're trying to achieve. Each day we have an objective, each day we have goals. And each day we have things that we try to accomplish. And I try to make sure that the techniques are correct and the alignments are correct and the plays are correct.
Coach's son, Vince, is a big part of many pit practices.
Vince is more or less a special guy. He's been coming up here for the past 3 years, and being only 11 years old, he has a sharp wit. And of course, I accredit that to the fact that the ball players have adopted him. And you know, he's always in a locker room, and some of the things he sees and hears for 11-year-old or when he was 9 years old, he has a little bit of an advantage. But he's out here, he interacts with them, he's like a coach to them, and he's a cheerleader, and you know, he's a very, very positive young man.
Defense didn't feel that it gave a good account of itself, having yielded 17 points to the Seminoles. So Foge Fazio, as a remedy this week, was thinking seriously of going very often to the blitz. Well, the blitz was not necessary. As you see from the tackles for loss column, Chris Dolman and company really had a field day, one of the more outstanding performances by a Pitt defensive line, perhaps in the recent Renaissance history. In short, the Panther front four seemed like, at times, they were parts of the Illini playbook.
Fullback was trying to kick me out. Fullback's only about 5'9", weighed about 210 pounds. He came and just kind of blocked him, a little too big for him to take on straight up, so he tried to cut me. He came across and I just hurtled over it. Therefore, just left me one-on-one with Easton.
Easton rolled out. He was scrambling a lot. He went from side to side, and I picked up the split end number four. I don't know what his name was, but he came to the sideline, and then as Easton got away from the rush, number four came back across the field. I just followed him, and Easton threw it up and put it right into my hands. That was it. Me and my speed, I just ran and got caught from behind like usual.
Easton was sacked 9 times by the Panther defense and suffered 5 interceptions. He'll probably have many better days in 1982 ahead. The Pitt defense simply was outstanding. Outstanding, the area of athletic achievement and certainly in the area of academic achievement. And those are the things that go hand in hand at the University of Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh archaeologists continue to uncover vital clues about our ancestors. At the much-acclaimed Meadowcroft site, the Pittsburgh team unearthed the earliest evidence of human habitation in the eastern United States.
Archaeology has changed dramatically since the 1920s. It's changed dramatically in the last few years. No longer does it bear even the slightest resemblance to the Raiders of the Lost Ark brand of research. The sorts of things we do now are not only directed toward the recovery of things, as it were, artifacts like those you see sitting here, but toward reconstructing the context in which these materials were found. Our basic strategy is to use state-of-the-art data recovery techniques coupled with state-of-the-art analytical procedures to get as concise a picture as is humanly possible of the prehistoric past in a particular area. Our research interests span a wide range of things, from the earliest peopling of North America on the one extreme to urban archaeology and the impact of, say, subway construction in urban environments on the other.
The heart of the Golden Triangle, the Pittsburgh team has uncovered fascinating discoveries about 19th century Pittsburghers. They dig alongside workers who are excavating for the city's new subway.
A very, very excellent sample of what people in 19th century Pittsburgh, the 1850s and a little bit later, were eating, and some of the ways in which they are processing their food can also be obtained from an analysis of this material. The most amazing single fact about all of this particular material is the fact that it's here at all, the fact that it's been preserved. This essentially represents an unwritten, if you will, legacy from the past.
The archaeologists' work is painstaking, whether it be at a site in rural Pennsylvania or in the heart of the city. But Pittsburgh archaeologists are helping to preserve an important non-renewable resource, our cultural past. Coming up, we're going to take a look at the week ahead, because it's a big rivalry game between Pitt and West Virginia that's less than a week away. Mountaineers, under Coach Don Nealon, the Mountaineers are one of the most rapidly improving ball clubs in all of college football. Number 15, Jeff Hostetler, a fine quarterback in the tradition of Oliver Luck, with a big 49-yard gain to number 48, Willie D. Willie Drury, in the big upset over Oklahoma. With 5 seconds to go in the half, Hostetler finds the ever-dangerous Darryl Miller open in the end zone. Miller back from knee injuries. Hostetler likes to find his running backs, and here he does. A neat little number with Curlin Beck, number 20. Also, a big weapon is number 85, and that's tight end Mark Rao. Special teams play is one of the highlights of a Don Nealon team. Little Willie Drury, one of the outstanding punt return and kickoff return men in the nation last year. Here's a 45-yard kickoff return against the Sooners. Against Maryland, the defense was obvious. Steve Newberry, a cornerback with a big interception. West Virginia plays the ball very well. They break to the ball as well as any secondary in the game. Free safety Tim Agee with another big Oski for the Mountaineers, a diving grab. Now we see the tandem of Steve Hathaway, one of the Western Pennsylvania players who likes to play hard, with help there for Mr. Outside, Darryl Talley on the sack. West Virginia likes to string it out, thanks to the presence of the big lineman, Todd Campbell, and run support from free safety, Tim Agee, one of the finest open field tacklers in the game today.
You know, West Virginia, throughout the years, points to this game more than anything. I mean, they could be 0-10, and we can be 10-0, and it doesn't mean a doggone thing, or vice versa. West Virginia would rather beat Pitt than anything else in their whole lives. And our guys know that, and we have to prepare the same way as West Virginia does, with intensity and being aware, and hopefully eliminate mistakes, because they're a great football team, and we're going to be in for a big battle again.
It's going to be pretty crazy. They're going to be hot and ready to beat us, and we're going to be up for them the same way they are for us, and we're just going to work real hard this week, and I'd prefer to look at it as win number four rather than a win against West Virginia. We're just trying to go 12-0, and they're the next team in line, so they're the ones that hopefully will suffer.
Yeah, it's the old backyard brawl, or whatever they call it, backyard rivalry. You know, they're going to be a good team. You know, they improved a lot since last year. They got a good quarterback. They got a tough defense, and we'll be ready for them. We got a week to prepare, so we'll be ready for them.
A sellout crowd at Pitt Stadium will watch the Panthers and the Mountaineers this coming weekend, and we'll tell you all about it next week, right here on Panther Pride 82.